Good morning, Centerview. Great to have you here this morning. I'd like to welcome you to our 11 o'clock service. For those who know me, I'm Pastor Mark, and Mark and Mike. I don't even know my name. Yeah, he's the one with the beard. I'm not. Okay. I'd like to go through a few announcements. This week, our Onslow Pregnancy Resource Center virtual banquet will be going on. That's a kind of confusing title because when we say virtual, people think they're staying home, and that is an option. You can get an email link to you, and we can send it. You can watch it at home, watch the video. You can get a group of friends together. But what we're doing here at Centerview on Thursday from 7 to 7:30 is we're having a banquet. A banquet meaning we're going to have a couple little things for you to eat with your food, not a full-on banquet like steak and potatoes, like we usually do when we don't have COVID. But it's an opportunity for you to get to learn about what the Onslow Pregnancy Resource Center is and what they do. Could you put that picture up for me, please? Thank you. They were born this week, correct, Ms. Stacy? 2 weeks ago, okay. So one of the things that the Onslow Pregnancy Resource Center does is they give out a pill that if a person decides they want to have an abortion and they change their mind, if they go in within a certain period of time, they can take this pill and it can reverse the process. Well, they went to the Onslow Pregnancy Resource Center and one of the counselors talked to them and I guess there were two heartbeats that they found when they did the sonogram. And now we have two babies. Precious babies born less than 2 weeks ago, thanks to the work of the OPRC and people like us that support them. We believe that all lives are important, and because of that, we're going to do what we can to try to rescue them. So please, if you haven't got it electronically, your newsletter, your monthly newsletter, we have physical copies in the back in the Welcome Center, and you can read about that, and you can read about it in your bulletin as well. After the service, our youth are selling youth attraction guides. They're Onslow County and in the local area attraction guides. They have various coupons for restaurants and businesses. They're $20 for a purchase of that. $10 of that goes to the youth, and you can easily recoup your money if you just use a few of those coupons. Our youth are also going to be hosting a silent auction 2 weeks from today on the 15th. Please, and you can read about this in your bulletin, bring items and or services that you're willing to donate. For example, my wife does an ice cream cake. Some people will say, I'll come and clean your yard or organize your office or make quilts and things like that. Bring all that stuff in by November 11th and give that to Miss Billy. You'll also notice in the bulletin, now that we're ramping back up, we're looking for Little Lambs and Sunday School helpers. You can see Miss Jennifer and my wife about those. There is an election Tuesday. Please vote. Our parking lot will be full. There'll be people coming in and out of there, so just be cautious if you come through this area. It's very dangerous if you're just wandering around not paying attention. Last two things I want to mention. OCC, our Operation Christmas Child, we have the shoeboxes out in the Welcome Center. Please fill them up and bring them in and put them in that large shoebox out there by November 18th. And you can read about that with that. And if you are a wife of a deployed, if your spouse is deployed, if you are a widow, if you are a single mom, we are reinstituting our Mom's Night Out. That starts up. I know a lot of the moms are very happy. They've told me that. On November 20th, and you can read about that in the bulletin. If you plan on coming to that, I'm not putting a sign-up sheet out. Just see me and let me know, or see Miss Jessica, let her know, and we'll get your name on there. I think that's all I have. Praise team, would you lead us in a song, please?
Let's stand and sing.
Thank you. We've done some singing. Now you can sit while we have a prayer and the offering. And let me just say, I love that song. And we have one superhero at Centerview Baptist Church. His name is King Jesus. He is the one we adore. He is our hero. He is the one that we lift high and we exalt. He is the Messiah. He was the one that the Old Testament said he is our soon coming Messiah. And now that he has come in his incarnation, his perfect life, his atoning death, his actual dead body buried, his actual risen body leaving the grave, preaching the spirits in hell, ascending back to the Father. He's at the right hand. He's ever living to make intercession for us. And this is the left out part of the gospel. He is coming again. We have one superhero at Centerview Baptist Church. His name is Jesus. I was hoping we might get raptured right as we were all singing the name Jesus. Well, dear ones, you know, I had a son-in-law who was playing along with his kiddos, and he was wearing a Superman outfit, and he sent me a picture, and that is funny. I'm not one of these pastors that's against kids getting some candy from neighbors or whatever, putting on their princess outfits. I was always a hobo, because I looked like a hobo anyhow. I just put a little more charcoal on my face and took the pillow out, had my pillowcase, and would run through the neighborhoods. But if for those scholarly Christians out there, yesterday was something else. It was 503 years since Martin Luther nailed to the church door in Wittenberg, Germany, his 95 theses. And here's what this Roman Catholic priest discovered. We are saved by grace alone, through faith alone, in the person and work of Jesus Christ alone. He got born again. He came into faith by reading and studying for his students and himself, taking them through the book of Romans. So at Centerview Baptist Church, we do rejoice in the five solas, the five alones of the Reformation that began 503 years ago. Christ alone, Scripture alone, grace alone, faith alone, and all for the glory of God alone. So we believe in the full-orbed truth of the good news of Jesus Christ. You have a Savior who saves you from the penalty of sin, justification, a Savior who delivers you from the power of sin, sanctification, and one day, the left-out part of the gospel, he is the King who's coming back, and in the twinkling of an eye. Now, here's what scholars who study that out in the Greek, you know, like some of you are blinking right now. Blink, that's like way slow. In the twinkling of an eye, it's a nanosecond. Zoom, bang, caught up to meet him forever and ever. You just missed a chance to say hallelujah. But anyhow, amen. Pastor Clyde taught me that one. He was the only one clapping too, but anyhow. As we go to the Lord in prayer, we're not going to pass the plate, but our offering today, our missionary in focus, is a family who are serving the Lord Jesus in the country of Thailand. We also have some other missionaries, the Godet family, who are in Thailand. Well, Todd and Katie Miller, serving through the IMB, the International Mission Board of the SBC, Southern Baptist Convention, they are ministering to, you know, there's so many areas that are worn, torn, and people groups within countries that are fleeing that country to a neighboring country. So last week we prayed for some missionaries in Burma. These are missionaries that are serving in Thailand, but it's a refugee people group that are fleeing Burma into Thailand. And so pray for Todd and Katie as they minister to refugees in Thailand. And here's our offertory scripture, Hebrews 13. Therefore, by him, let us continually offer the sacrifice of praise to God, that is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. But do not forget to do good and to share. For with such sacrifices, God is well pleased. Christ, the one to whom we're to offer the praise of our lips and to the Father and to the Spirit, you know, he forever and ever atoned for our sin. There's no more sacrifice. Jesus made the final sacrifice for our sins. But the apostle said, at the same time, I want you to give your bodies like a living sacrifice. One of the things that we sacrificially do is serve God by giving back our tithes and by our offerings. Let me just say, sometimes I look at Stacy and she looks a little serious. But you would too if you saw all of her prayer requests. If you saw the prayer requests of, like sometimes her email might have 70 families, cases where describes the dynamics, you know, the father of the child is not a believer, the mother is a, you know, struggling with her faith, and, you know, she carries a heavy, heavy burden. So when we put tithes into play, it not only supports at this church missionaries like Todd and Katie, it supports the OPRC. Once again, I want to affirm what Pastor Mark said. It's virtual, but on the 5th, we're actually going to get together and have cookies. While we watch the thing virtually, we're actually, at Centerview, we're going to be here. And it says up to 60. We're not going to sound a horn at 62. So please mark your calendar for November 5th, and whether you go online. And Ms. Stacy, do you want us to log on? Is it important to you that we log on and register? It is, because they're encouraged by that. They know, you know, she's a member of our church, but listen, this is a, you know, just frankly, it's an interfaith. There are other Christian churches that are not Southern Baptist. There are other churches that are from other denominations. They're all partnering together. Wouldn't it be nice if the director's church stood up just a little bit? I don't want to embarrass, but just only a handful of people registered. So if you don't know how to do it, here's what you do. You ask your grandchild. So I will say, Jonah, come help Grandpa. I need to go to www.oprcfriends.com. Jonah, can you show me how to do that? And Jonah will say, give me that phone. And he'll do it, and then it'll pop up, and he'll show you where to click. And your grandkid will do the same thing if you let them. They will. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. As we go to the Lord in prayer and thanking God for the offering, which we won't actually do, but the boxes are there. We also know that you have needs. We also are acutely aware of the fact that some people are sick. I have a friend, a dear friend, out-of-state friend, who has COVID-19. His whole family has it, and he said, man, we are sick. We are like, got the flu. We got the whole deal. We can't taste anything. We can't smell anything. We are really like super flu. Doctor thinks they're going to be, you know, survive it. But, you know, there are people in our life who are really sick in a lot of ways. There are people still in the nursing homes that can't come. There are people still isolated that can't come. But by the way, every Sunday when I see new faces, I'm like, yay. I'm so happy. I saw a couple that I hadn't seen, and they had a little baby, and that this was their first Sunday back. So we're glad you're here, and we know that you have needs, and God knows too. Let's go to him. Father, thank you that through Christ we have access into your throne room of grace, and we can come boldly. And Father, it almost gives us in a silly kind of way, a sense of arrogance that we can just come to you. We don't even need to make an appointment. God, you're so gracious. You're so awesome. You just say, come boldly to the throne room of grace to obtain mercy and find grace to help in your time of need. For you've given us a high priest, your son Jesus, who took on flesh like us, made like unto one of us, in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. And because of that, you said you are touched with the feeling of our infirmities. So, God, we're thankful that through the shed blood of Christ, the veil of the temple was torn in two from the top to the bottom, showing us that through his blood, we can come before you and we can cry out, Abba, Father. We have been adopted into your family through the blood of your son. We praise you. We adore you. Give us hearts today to worship you in spirit and in truth. We do pray for Todd and Katie today as they are serving you in Thailand and have said goodbyes to family and to friends and to houses and lands and have forsaken all to follow you and to let others know that your son loves them and your son died for them. God, strengthen them and their ministry, we pray in Jesus' name. We thank you for OPRC. We thank you for Miss Stacy. We know that the burdens she carries are heavy. And yet, Lord, you are the great burden bearer. You are the one through whom we can do all things because you strengthen us. So God, continue to strengthen her for the hard work of directing the OPRC. Give us hearts of compassion. Give us hearts of partnership with her and the other volunteers at OPRC. May the 5th be a great day where people not only show up and sign up, but where they make pledges, they make commitments to sustain this work, dear God, to speak up as a voice for those who cannot speak up for themselves. Thank you, Master, that you are the champion of the widow and the fatherless. Help us to stand with you, dear God. We love you for the family that's hurting, for the family that's going through something that no one else knows. Thank you, Master, that you know. And would you meet them at their point of need? And God, would you just abide with us as we continue to worship you in song now, and as we open your book, and as we hear, thus saith the Lord, God, would you just show yourself in power, and may all the glory be thine, in Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand and sing together, and then a message from God's word.
Sound of his voice.
Thank you so much, and especially Miss Micah for taking the lead on that. And I think Micah would agree with me that you can sing, because of Christ, you can sing "It Is Well With My Soul," even when all things are not so well in your life. And I'm wondering if some sharpo deacons could bring a few more chairs down here for a family that needs to be socially distanced. And we want everyone to be comfortable. Don't go anywhere. They're going to make a chair for you. All right. Turn with me, if you would, in your Bibles to 1 John chapter 1. We're going to go to chapter 2 in 1 John. And so the title of this, the overarching title for this series is, you know, Building an Intentional Faith. 1 John is Assurance in the Faith. And the title of the message that we began last week that will be finished today, Lord willing, is Divine Intervention. Divine intervention is available, dear ones, for all who repent and believe the gospel. May as well just say out of the gate, this is a hill on which your pastor is willing to die. I believe with all of my heart, soul, mind, and strength that everyone under the sound, so to speak, of the preacher's voice, which is nothing more, as Spurgeon would say, preaching is giving the Bible a voice. Open God's book up and let God speak. God's word he's a lion. He's a tiger. Open up. Let God roar. He will roar. And so it's available to you. Honestly to goodness, if I thought that salvation was not available to you, I would not stand up and burst out my lungs and strip my voice sometimes down to the bare roots of the vocal cords if I didn't believe it. In fact, I don't know how those who don't believe Jesus saves, as Clyde would like to say, from the guttermost to the uttermost, can even stand and open the book and preach to people. If you really think the sheep don't have a chance, I don't know how you can preach. I just couldn't do it. I would feel like I was lying. You know, most of you ain't going to make it, but let's listen to it anyhow. Wow. Well, so dear ones, last week we looked at the first part of this message. John, the beloved apostle of love, said, my little children, these things I write unto you so that you may not sin. Now, we call that an admonition from our Father in heaven. It's an exhortation, it's an encouragement that you don't have to keep on sinning, because John's referring to them as his little children. Little children in the faith, we're all sons of God. We're all daughters of God through faith in Jesus Christ. No Jew, no Greek, no male, no female, no slave, no free. It's not male, female thing. Christ! He is the Savior. The Savior gives us an admonishment. For those who are in Christ, hey, stop sinning. We know that we're still going to sin because our master, now he could never pray the Lord's Prayer. We call it the Lord's Prayer. That's bogus, because the Lord himself could never say, give me this day my daily bread, forgive me my debts as I forgive. The Lord Jesus could never pray the Lord's Prayer because he's not a sinner in need of a Savior. He said, in this manner, you guys pray. And one of the things he said is, you know, pray, give us this day our daily bread. But then he said, pray. And this is a model for daily prayer, a model for daily prayer, not a mantra that's to be recited mindlessly 100 times. You know, forgive us our debts, our trespasses, our sins, just like we're forgiven others. We're sinners saved by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. We have no right to withhold your grace from others. So this is the admonition. My little children, stop this pattern of sin in your lives. Why was he writing this, by the way? We have to understand what it was to the original audience 2,000 years ago. You know, Jesus Christ pierced the darkness. He became God in the flesh. God. God in the flesh. That's what Isaiah told the people. The Lord himself is going to give you a sign. The virgin shall conceive. She shall bring forth a son. It's the first learned word I learned in Hebrew, Emmanuel. Because, you know, they break it down and it's one word in English, but in Hebrew it's three words. God with us. What? God took on flesh. We have a high priest who is touched with the feeling of our infirmities. Jesus Christ, though he thought it not robbery to be made equal with God, took upon himself the form of a servant. The incarnation is not a subtraction that Jesus stopped being God. No, he's always been God. He is God. He always will be God. He's the same today, yesterday, and forever. He became, in the incarnation, one of us. Wow. And so the Bible says, if you have him, you have an advocate. So there's an admonition because of Jesus. Stop letting your life be identified by an endless, reckless pattern of sin. Jesus came to, don't you know, to save us from our sin. You shall call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sin. Not just the penalty of sin, justification, but the power of sin, sanctification. One day, this is the cool part, one day he's taking us to his house. And in his house, nothing can enter in that defiles or is unclean. And the only way you're going in, sweetie, the only way you're going in, sir, the only way you're going in, ma'am, the only way you're going in, young person, is on the coattails of Jesus. And we're going to learn about it today because you have received the propitiation. That's an important word. We're going to learn that word today. If you don't learn anything else when you leave church, I want you to be able to say, Pastor Mike taught us point three, which is divine atonement. Jesus alone is qualified to settle your sin debt. Why is this so important? Because the original audience had people invading the church called Gnostics. And they believed in various forms of Gnosticism. And Gnostics, you know, to know, they thought they knew special inside knowledge. And there were so many offshoots from it. But at its core, it's this, that, you know, that which is fleshly is sinful. Don't even fight it. So if you're in Christ, yeah, you've been saved. Just go ahead. Let it rip. Live like the devil. Who cares? Spiritually, you're pure. So don't even fight it. It was Docetism that, you know, all matter is evil. Therefore, they even had this wigged out theology that said Jesus wasn't God in the flesh. But at his baptism, the Spirit of Christ descended on him. And at his death, before he died, the Spirit of Christ left him. What? Insane. And so falsehood had invaded the church. And people were being told, don't even resist sin. You're saved, that's all that matters. Paul answered that. You know, where sin did abound, grace did much more abound. What then? Should we continue in sin to give God's grace a chance to keep on abounding? God forbid. Christ died for your sins. This is the gospel. 1 Corinthians 15:3. In the clearest statement of the gospel, Christ died for our sins according to Scripture. Not so you could wallow in them, so you could be delivered. If the Son sets you free, you shall be free indeed. Stand with me to honor God now as we drill down on verse 2, which is so good. It's so good. I'm going to read aloud. You read along with me. Having said, if we sin, we have an advocate. He's our lawyer. He's our attorney. He's our representative before the Father. Jesus Christ, the righteous one. The one who is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us when we do slip, but the pattern of life should be living for him. Now he says this, and he, speaking of Jesus, he himself, sometimes I write that and people say it's not good English. The Bible uses it, I'm going with it. He himself is the propitiation for our sins, our missing of the mark, our foibles, our failures, our mess ups, and not for ours only. Here it is. But also for the whole world. Father, this is more than we can take in into our finite minds. And God, would you just help us to be so caught up for a little bit here with the glory of King Jesus that we will all have a sense of loss of self-consciousness, but awareness of our hero, the person and work of the Lord Jesus Christ. In His name we pray and for His glory. Amen. You may be seated. And so the Bible says He Himself is our propitiation. Now, if in a normal conversation yesterday you used the word propitiation, please raise your hand. Scanning, 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 seeing no hands. Like a business meeting. Seeing none, hearing none, we move on. No, so it's not a word we use every day. But this word matters. It's an important word. John MacArthur stated the case well when he said this: propitiation through the death of Christ is one of the critical doctrines of the Christian faith, and it is at the center of God's redemptive plan. Why, yes, it is. And so, dear ones, I do not just re-preach old messages. I mean, in a crisis, I would, and sometimes I need to revisit things that I preach, and I looked at the outline and said, man, I really can't improve in that, so I'm going to refresh myself. But in this case, I did not look at my sermon notes in this from 20 years ago when I preached this book. So here's the thing. I looked at a list of synonyms that I made up or that I used many years ago, 20 years ago. And synonyms are not stuff that you put on toast. Synonyms. They are words that can help us to understand another word because they're like that word. And so here's some of the synonyms that I used. First of all, substitutionary sacrifice. We believe in the penal, substitutionary, atoning work of the Lord Jesus, that God has cast His judgment on sin. Ezekiel said it so simply, all souls belong to me, and the soul that sins shall die. The Son's not going to die for the sins of the Father and vice versa. But here's the thing, all have sinned. All have come short of the glory of God. God has righteously decreed that sin will be judged. And so this word, halasmos in the Greek, not important that you know that, can be described using the word substitution. And also the word sacrifice, a full and sufficient, perfect offering for sin. Here's another word, covering. We're going to come back to this word, but it's something that fully and completely blots out our sin. We are born, dear ones, DOA. David talked about that in the 51st Psalm. We are born into this world. And in fact, every one of you was DOA. You know, Paul said it this way to the church at Ephesus, and you hath he quickened, you hath he made alive, who were once dead in trespasses and sins. Now, I love little babies. I saw a little baby named Ella this morning in my office. I love babies. But dear ones, babies are born sinners in need of a Savior. Sorry about that. I know they're precious. I know you would step in front of a truck for them. I would too. But they're little sinners in need of a Savior. By the way, until they come to the age of accountability, I have a book in my office that I give moms and dads that lose children in infancy, whether from the womb or one of the worst things. I don't even like to say it because my mind goes back to doing a funeral for a two-year-old. But little ones that die go right to be with the Lord because they haven't reached the age of accountability. That's another subject for another day. But here's the thing. The blood of Jesus Christ is a covering for our sin. It's a satisfaction. It means God's righteous requirement for divine judgment against sin has been met on the person of His Son. We're gonna look at some B-I-B-L-E verses that tell us that. But that's a good synonym. Here's another one, payment in full. You know, when Martin Luther 503 years ago nailed his 95 theses to the door, it reminds me that the Apostle Paul told us in Colossians 2 that Christ has taken the handwriting of all the ordinances that were written against us, and He nailed it to the cross. And there's a sense in which it's paid in full. That's a good word. It's a good word picture. And another synonym, which is the final one that was in my notes, and I'm going to use it today, is the word appeasement. Now, some people don't like the word appeasement. It ruffles feathers from some folks. And I don't mean to be silly here, but, you know, kids have a thing called an angry bird. And some people don't like this because they see God as like an angry bird or something. God is this angry mogul that has to be satisfied, and they don't like the word. And there are some false gods who are out there who, quite frankly, are angry, and there's no walk with him. There's no love relationship with him. And I'm just going to say point blank, the five pillars of Islam, where's the love? I mean, it's all things that you must do. In Christianity, God turns everything up on its head. He comes and does it for us. He lives a perfect life for us. He dies an atoning death for us. And then he has preachers stand up, and faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And it says it pleased him by the foolishness of preaching just to save people who will believe. Wow. You mean I don't have to do anything? No. Someone asked about church membership. Do you got to do this? You got to do this? You got to repent and believe the gospel. And we'd like for you to be baptized. You're still going to be saved even if you don't get baptized, but you may as well go ahead and start obeying him now. And he says, you know, be baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So, dear ones, MacArthur said this. Appeasement, or he said this about the word propitiation. In definition and application, it's notably, most notably, a biblical and theological word. So you should know this word. Yeah, you should. And he said this. It is a translation, I've already told you, the Greek word halasmos, which means appeasement. That very word means appeasement. Another synonym would be satisfaction. He went on to say, Christ's sacrificial death on the cross satisfied the demands of God's justice, thus appeasing his holy wrath against believers' sins. The Dallas Theological Seminary professors wrote a sentence that was so cute, I just thought I would share it with you. I mean, here's what they said. God's wrath against sin may not be a concept congenial to the modern mind. In other words, it is not politically correct to say, you're a filthy, rotten, wicked sinner, and God's wrath is abiding on you unless you repent and believe in his Son. And his substitutionary atonement, his goodness will be imputed to your life. You have none of your own. Well, that's not congenial to the modern mind. That was a polite way for them to say that. No, it's not. But they went on to say the cross has indeed propitiated, which does mean to appease. It does mean to satisfy. It does speak of an atoning sacrifice that God has met his righteous demands. In other words, dear ones, Billy Graham wrote a book called Peace with God. At 21 years of age, I was a young renegade running from the things of the Lord. I went with a brother-in-law to a remote cabin in Canada. We had no power. There were no books there, but there was one little book on the shelf called Peace with God. And Billy Graham explained it, and I understood for the first time in my life that I am a wicked sinner, and my sin deserves the wrath of God. The Bible says, Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first, all to the Greek. For in it, the righteousness of God is revealed from heaven, as it is written, you know, from faith to faith, the just shall live by faith. And he went on to say these words, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men. Yeah, men, women, boys and girls, apart from the intervening grace of God, are sinners. Go all the way back to the Garden of Eden. We've all sinned. We've all come short of the glory of God. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Isaiah 53 looks to the cross. But God has laid on him the iniquity of all. We all deserve a whipping for sin. We all deserve to die and go to hell. There it is. But Jesus died. And I don't want to argue with some folks, but he actually, the Bible says, if you believe the Bible, he went and preached to the spirits. And now we don't know all the ramifications of that, but I'm just going to go with what the Bible says, that, you know, that he did that. And he, the one who knew no sin, became sin for us that we, in turn, might be made the righteousness of God in him. The Bible says he is the chastisement for our peace. I don't care how you raise your children. That's up to you. But when they willfully sin, you know, Diane and I read a book called Dare to Discipline before we even had kiddos. And here's what I do know. When a child bows its back and stomps its foot and says no, I'm not going to submit. The battle is on. And here's what the Bible says. Jesus took the whipping. He took the chastisement for our peace. It was upon him. By his stripes, Someone has to get stripes. Why? Because God said the soul that sins shall die. He cannot undo what he has said. We have so many illustrations of what you could use in the Bible from the law of the Medes and the Persians. You know, a decree would be made, it can't be undone. How much more is God righteous? He cannot undo the decree that he himself made. But what he has decided is, I can allow a substitute to take that whipping for you. And his son, the Lord Jesus, took our whipping. He was nailed. He was pierced. He was wounded. His life's blood flowed from him. He bled out. He died on the cross, crying out, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what to do." He appeased the very righteous, just wrath of God, divinely appropriate against sin. And for the first time when I read that book, Peace with God, I understood it, that it's a swaparoo. We come to the cross, Jesus already paid for our sin debt, and he says, "Here's my blood, the blood that flowed from Emmanuel's vein, it's sufficient to cover your sin as well." We already read it, but can I just remind you about it? If we say we have fellowship with God, walk in darkness, we lie. We do not the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, help me out, church, cleanseth us from all sin. It's only the blood of Christ that can make you acceptable in the sight of God. We all need the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ that Jesus saves. The word carries with it, my seminary president, Danny Aiken, said, the word carries with it the idea of satisfaction. Jesus Christ, by his bloody sacrifice on the cross, satisfied God's holiness. He turned away his righteous wrath from sinners. The wrath that should have been poured out on sinners was poured out on Jesus. The judgment that should have been experienced by sinners was experienced by Jesus. The hell that should have been experienced by sinners was experienced by Jesus. I like to make that a little more personal and just simply use the personal pronoun, the wrath of God that should have been experienced by me and by you was instead experienced by King Jesus. So, dear ones, the Bible gives the best illustration of this that I can ever think of. I am not trying to turn you into seminarians. You don't have to go get a degree in Greek or Hebrew to know the Bible. You can just pick it up between you and God, the Holy Spirit. You can read and your mind can be illuminated through the Word of God. But let me remind you of Sunday school and of a little fact here about, you know, between 2,000 and 2,300 years ago, scholars debate, a little book was written called the Septuagint. And you know what it was? It was a book that transferred the Old Testament, which was written in Hebrew, it translated it into Greek. And in that Hebrew Bible, of course, there's something called the Ark of the Covenant. Now, if you watch the Raiders of the Lost Ark, you will not get the significance of the Ark of the Covenant. I promise you. But you're going to get it today. Because here's the thing. In the Ark of the Covenant, you know, time fails us to tell you all the things that, you know, you might would like to know and would be blessed to know. All the action's up here, so don't worry about it. So let me just say this. God said, make an ark. And in that ark, here's what I want you to do. I want you to make a little chest. And in that little chest, I want you to put the testimony. What is that? The law. And what did James say? If you've broken the law in any one point, what have you broken? All of it. So in that little ark, and the ark, by the way, was in the Holy of Holies. What did the Holy of Holies represent? The very presence of God. And what would happen in the Ark of the Covenant? Here's what would happen in the ark. The Bible, the Old Testament law, the tablets were put in there. And then there was something called a mercy seat that covered the law, the mercy seat. Amen? The mercy seat. And what was on the mercy seat? Some angels, you know, had they had their wings. We read from Isaiah that, you know, with two they flew, with two they covered their feet, with two they covered their eyes. But they were kind of looking away and looking up. And what would happen? Leviticus 16, read all about it. On the Day of Atonement, the annual Day of Atonement, the high priest representing the mediator between God and man. By the way, the Bible says there is one mediator between God and man, the man Jesus Christ, the righteous, who gave his life as a ransom for all. So here's what happened on the annual Day of Atonement. The high priest, they'd tie a little rope around his leg, because if he did anything wrong, he would be struck dead. Remember the Sunday school lesson, Uzzah, who reached out to stabilize the cart that was about to fall with the Ark of the Covenant, and God struck him dead. What's the lesson? You cannot come to God any old way. You come the only way that he says to come, which is the high priest swinging the incense thing and throwing that incense on that mercy seat, and the steam would rise up representing the Shekinah glory of God, and the priest would take the blood from a spotless lamb, and what would he do? He would sprinkle it on that mercy seat. And it was the life of the lamb for the life of the people. It was a picture of the substitutionary atoning work of Jesus Christ. And in the Greek Septuagint, the word for mercy seat is this word, halasmos. And so, dear ones, the word in the New Testament is there in the Old Testament. The only covering for our sin. Because we have all broken the law. I mean, the Bible has said, we got some good, sweet, wonderful members. I love you to death. But you're sinners. And your pastor, as best as I know, is the chief sinner. I like to say I'm the most wicked man I know because I know me better than I know you. I can't crawl inside your heart, know your wickedness. Mine is enough. Yuck. Now, do not extrapolate that out to mean Pastor Mike's living a double life. No, I'm not saying that at all. I'm just saying we are all sinners in need of the one and only Savior. And by the way, I may as well roll it out right now. There is no other way. If there was another way, the Bible would have told us there's another way. Don't sweat it. But the Bible tells us again and again and again. I'll just pick Acts 4:12. Neither is there, how clear is this? Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name given under heaven among men whereby we must be saved. Jesus says the name that is above every name, at the name of Jesus, every knee is going to bow, every tongue is going to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. The only mercy for our sin, because God is looking down on man who we've all broken his law, the only mercy that can cover our sin is the shed blood of Jesus Christ. And so Hebrews 9 and 10, let me just read a little from 9. According to the law, almost all things are purified with blood, and without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. Therefore, it was necessary that the copy of things in heaven should be purified with these. In other words, when the priest would kill the goat, kill the ram, kill the bullock, shed the blood, it was all pointing to the day when Jesus would come. For Christ has entered not the holy places made with hands. You know, he didn't enter the holy of holies in the tabernacle or in the temple. The Bible says let me just read from verse 24 and following. Christ has not entered the holy places made with hands, which are copies of the true, but into heaven itself, to now appear in the presence of God for us. 7:25 of the same book says he ever lives to make intercession. The word of God continues. Not that he should offer for himself often, as the high priest did. You know, as you read Leviticus 16, the high priest, you know what he had to do before he could even go in to offer the atonement for the sins of the people? He would have to sacrifice a lamb for his own sins and the sins of his own family. Jesus, not so. And so, offer himself often, as the high priest enters the most holy place every year with blood of another, he would then have to offer, he would have to suffer often since the foundation of the world. But now, in the end of the ages, he has appeared to put away sin, here it is, by the sacrifice of himself. This is that wonderful passage where Jesus said, you know, a sacrifice for a sin you did not desire, but a body thou hast prepared for me, O God. Jesus Christ, the one who knew no sin, took our sin upon his body on the tree, that we, having died to sin, might live to righteousness. That's why when John the Baptist saw Jesus, he just said this, wow, the Lamb of God, which takes away the sin of the world. So I was talking with a couple today. Let me just share. Hebrews 10:10 says, we've been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Yeah. So when Jesus died and rose again for you, your sin debt has forever been settled. Past, present, future. But now we're on this earth called, this place called planet Earth, and we're not yet home. So verse 14 says, of that same text, for by one offering he has perfected forever those who are being sanctified. It's an already but not yet thing. We are in the process of becoming more and more like Christ. Now, let me cut to the chase and say this, and I'm going to invoke the words of John MacArthur. I hinted at this last week. He said, there's only two ways for sin to be satisfied. And you said, well, I thought there was only one way. Well, there's a second way. The second way for sin to be satisfied is this. You go to hell, and you spend eternity there, and it's Christless. Now, people want to argue, is hell literal? Will there be flames? Will there be suffering? Well, dear ones, I'm going to tell you this. My Jesus talked about utter darkness where there'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth, where he said their worms will not die and their flames shall not be diminished. Do I believe that there's an actual hell awaiting the devil and his angels? Yes. And God doesn't desire one man or woman or boy and girl to go there. How do I know that? Jesus said so. It was created for the devil and his angels. But if you reject the amazing love of God, made freely available, freely Jesus said you would receive, freely give. If you reject God's offering of, I mean, what more could he do than allow his son to die for you? The son who is crying out, Father, forgive them. So one way for it to be settled is for unbelievers to go to hell for all eternity. I hope you will not let it be settled that way. Here's the other way. By repenting of our sin and believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. When Jesus began his preaching, he just was so crisp, so clear. I mean, he was unlike Mikey, who gets tongue-tied. I couldn't even read a Bible verse a while ago. Jesus isn't that way, man. He said, here it is, ready? The time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. You ready for a sermon? All of its fullness, all of its glory? Repent and believe the gospel. The Philippian jailer said, sirs, what must I do to have what you have, this thing called salvation? Wasn't a big, long, fancy speech. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. If we are so filled with pride and arrogance that we push back on the free offer of grace and say, no thanks, don't need it, I'm a good man, you will justly spend an eternity. And here's the thing I want to say. I don't even want to argue about what's there, what's not there. There are different levels. Let's just say what the Bible says. To him that knew not his father's will, there'll be, punishment. To him who knew his father's will and did, be even greater punishment. There, just like in heaven, there'll be rewards. In hell, there'll probably be some different things going on. But here's the part. It's Christless. And it's eternity. It's appointed unto man once to die, and after this is the judgment. So, dear ones, here's some great divine intervention news. Jesus alone is qualified to settle your sin debt. But we haven't even talked about the last part of the verse. How can you do this in just a matter of minutes? So easy. So let's look at it. And not ours only, but also for the whole world. So, dear ones, this is another hill in which your pastors are willing to die at Centerview Baptist Church. God does not want you to perish. I know this because I've actually read the Bible. 2 Peter 3:9. The Lord is not slack concerning his promises. Some men count slackness, but is long suffering to usward. Here's what the Bible says, not willing for any to perish, but for all to come to the knowledge of truth. I can read my Bible and say, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Learn John 3:17. God did not send his Son into the world to condemn it, but that the world might be saved. Don't put a bum rap on God. God wants you to be joyfully, wondrously saved, to come into a relationship. He wants to adopt you. And by the way, we're all adopted. God has no grands. I got 10 grands. Love him, love him, love him, love him, love him. God has no grands. He just has kids. The only way to come into his family as one of his children and become one of his little ones, my little children, is to repent of your sin. That is a God-wrought change of heart and mind that leads to a change of direction in life. It's God breaking you down where you reach a point of saying, I call it submit or go mad. I'm done. Forgive me. Lord Jesus, you cry out in faith, save me, like the thief on the cross. You might not have fancy words. God sees the heart. If you shall confess with your mouth that Jesus is the Lord, if you shall believe in your heart that God hath raised his son from the dead, thou shalt be saved. This is what the Bible says. So here's the thing. This sacrifice of Jesus Christ is available to the whole world. And I know people like to argue about election and such matters. Let me just say what the Bible says. He himself, Jesus Christ, is propitiation. That's the covering, appeasing, satisfactory offering for sins, the only one that God can accept for our sins, and not for ours only, but for the sins of the whole world. Now, I've read the Bible. Not everyone's going to go up. I've read the Bible. Have you read the Bible? Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount, there's a wide road and a broad gate. It's leading to destruction. And here's some sad words. He said, many there be that go in thereat. And then he said, you know, there's a narrow road. By the way, he said, I am that road. I am the way. I'm the truth. I am the life. And there's a narrow little gate that leads to life. He said, few there will be. And this is sad news. That will go in thereat. How many mornings have you heard me talk about a missionary here, a missionary there? And I'd say 96% of the people are lost. Only 1% of the people are saved. You've driven around Jacksonville. How many people are going to church this morning? In all of Jacksonville, 20% at the most. 80% every Sunday, Sunday after Sunday after Sunday after Sunday after Sunday, do not go to any house of worship. And many of those who are going to a bum house of worship. I'm just saying. But there are lots of good ones that preach the gospel. Amen? I mean, Miss Stacy partners with a lot of them. There's a lot of good ones out there. There really and truly are. But do you think that America is predominantly saved? I don't think so. Just look at the two candidates. I'm going for the one that doesn't kill babies. You got to make your decision under your own conscience. William McDonald said this. This does not mean that the whole world is saved. Rather, it means that the work of the Lord Jesus is sufficient in value to save all the world. But it is only efficient for those who actually put their trust in him. Jesus himself said, if you do not believe in me, he said this to his own people. He came to his own people, if you do not believe in me, you will die in your sins. What happens when you die in sin? According to the Bible, you go to hell. He said again in Luke 13, if you do not repent, you will, you know, do you think these other bad guys that had something happen, you think they were worse than, unless you repent, you will all likewise perish. This is the word of the Lord. Danny Aiken said this, and I'm with him, man. We had a big, he was my actual professor, the president there. I was the only one in my, well, there was me and one other guy in our doctoral class that did not believe in the limited atonement as the way some do. I believe the shed blood of Christ is sufficient for the sins of the whole world. But I do believe that he himself limited it. Only those who repent and believe the gospel will be saved. There it is. That's what the Bible says. Let's just say what the Bible says. Danny Aiken said, no one is beyond its reach, period. And then he had a new sentence, no one, period. If I did not believe that, I wouldn't have the heart to preach. I think you got a shot, man. Here's your shot today. Repent and believe the gospel. Here's what Jerry Vines, listen, I don't want no heroes but Jesus. I was associating myself with young guys in seminary. Why? Because they all went to seminary probably when they should have. I didn't go until I was in my mid-40s and didn't cross the stage with my doctorate until I was 59. And so I was an old geezer. And Diane and I were at a convention once, and it was Jerry Vines, and he was signing Bibles for people. She said, go get your Bible signed by Dr. Vines. And I'm like, I'm not a little groupie. I'm not going to go get my Bible signed. And she said, go get your Bible signed. You like him. I felt like such a groupie afterwards. I'm like, oh, my goodness. But Jerry Vines did say this in his little book on this. If you haven't repented and believed in the Lord Jesus, not one word of this applies to you. You are not covered. And you are destined for a very real sinner's hell. But can I bring you back to verse 7? Let's go back to verse 6. If we say we're walking in the light, but we're walking in darkness, we're lying. The truth isn't really in us. But if we walk in the light as he is light, in other words, you come to the light. Jesus said, this is the condemnation. Men come to light, but they love the darkness rather than the light. They wouldn't come to it unless they're eagerly. So you got to come to the light. You got to say, Jesus, I know you're the light of the world. Expose my darkness. I repent. I turn. I believe in you. And then the Bible says, the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanseth us from all sin. Father, if there's one even today that has not yet said yes to Jesus, oh, today might they cry out for their repentance from their sin and cry out, Lord Jesus, save me. Father, for those of us who have this knowledge, would you help us to live like we have this knowledge? To throw rope to others in Jesus' name and for his glory. Amen. Let's stand, let's sing, let's respond if God has led you to do so. Going to ask Pastor Clyde to dismiss us in a word of prayer before he does, and we will, I believe we're having a Awana Club, and Pastor Mark's preaching tonight, everything like normal, so hope to see you tonight. But before Clyde leads us in a word of prayer, I just want to tell you that in your pew back, there's a little white card, some of them have it, and if you would like to talk with the pastor one-on-one, I just spent a beautiful hour, here's under the new format, preaching at 8:30, I'm free at 9:45. I just spent an hour with a couple. The great preacher of the Puritan age, Richard Baxter, said, I can do more in an hour of close discourse with a family than I can in a year of preaching, a year of Sabbath, as he would say it. It's true. So if you'd like to talk about your relationship with Christ, I know the invitation is like so rushed and so fast, and you got deep things, and you really can't do it in a 60-second soundbite. So if you'd like to talk with your pastor one-on-one, nothing makes me happier than to do that. Whether we can do it on Sunday morning, whether we make an appointment, we do house calls, we'll meet you at the church at your convenience. So do not leave here with a troubled heart. Please fill out a card. One of your pastors, myself included, would love to talk to you one-on-one. Pastor Clyde, would you dismiss this kind, sir?
Thank you, thank you, thank you, Father, for the blood of Jesus Christ, yes, that cleanses us from all sin. We give you praise, we give you glory alone. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said,
amen. Amen. God bless you.